In this presentation, I will talk about web author, and I will highlight some of the features that help subject matter experts create high quality structured content. Most of the features were added like in the last year. Some of them are also were also present in the earlier versions. So first of all, we explain web author as being the Oxygen XML author desktop application plus HTML5. This is a good way to explain web author to people already familiar with Oxygen XML author. The problem is this is not the whole truth. The whole truth is that Oxygen web author and author are similar, which means they use the same technology. They can be configured using a common format for the configuration files, and they share most of the high-level concepts like the toolbar structure, the content completion window, and so on. And and web author uses HTML5, but actually the correct version of the equation is web author is Oxygen XML author for SMEs. And the HTML5 is just a technology choice which makes sense for SMEs because they use the tool only occasionally, so they won't won't install a desktop application which they will use like several times a week. Okay. So subject matter experts are people that have a deep knowledge in the domain of the documents that of the XML documents, but they can be engineers, doctors, and so on. But their common particularity is that they don't know XML. So I will go through several tasks that subject matter experts should perform in order to contribute to create high quality XML content. So I will start with the beginning. First of all, they have to access the XML content. With the desktop applications, they would have to download the content from somewhere, find exactly the place, and find the tools that they need to download, and so on. With web author, we already had a couple of plugins, like the Git plugin, the WebDAV plugin, and the SharePoint plugin, which is not configured here. In the new version of web author, we added support for Perforce Helix, which is a versioning system control used is similar to Git, but is more enterprise oriented somehow. And also for CMIS. CMIS is it's an open standard that can be implemented by CMSs. Some implementations that we know of is Alfresco, SharePoint on-premise, and FileNet. These are the most popular ones. So one thing that we did with the CMIS plugin is that instead of showing a generic icon and a generic name here, we let the server administrator configure the icon and the display name for the server, so that users will feel at home when they say, oh, the content is stored on my Alfresco server, not what it's CMIS, because CMIS is just a protocol. People don't know what that means. Also, For example, in our Fresco, you can see that if you just open a server, it has a default repository, and then it has a lot of directories, which some of them aren't supposed to contain XML documentation. So in order to make people's life easier, we added support in WebAuthor to specify an URL parameter here to point users directly to one of the folders in the CMS, instead of having them browse and locate the folder they need to create the content into. For example, this is the URL of the guest home folder. It has a complicated format, but it's documented in our user manual, and we will also create like a share button that you can use to obtain this link. So for this presentation, I already created such a link. So if you follow it, you go directly to the guest home folder. Another feature that we added to WebAuthor to make people to let people easier access XML content is to allow anonymous Git access. So sometimes people use a Git repository only as a backend of a larger solution, and they ask people to log in before, like in the bigger applications that embeds WebAuthor. So there is no point in asking people again to log into the backend Git repository. So to solve this issue, we made WebAuthor work with Git. So you have an option to configure WebAuthor to use a service account to connect to the Git repository. So everyone connects with the same credentials which are configured on the server. And this removes one step from the people way to access XML content. Another feature that we implemented is adding support for Git submodules. Git submodules is a feature of Git that can be used to split a larger project in multiple repositories. For example, here I simulated splitting the flowers project in multiple repositories. For example, the images repository might be synchronized from a digital assets management system, so designers are creating images there, and there is an automatic job synchronizing them to the images folder, and then included in the main project as a submodules. Also, I created a reusable folder that includes another project that can contain, for example, legal material like copyright, various warnings like do not use this power tool while you are sleepy or something like this. And then people can include parts of that content in their main project just by adding links. And I'm actually going to show you how it works. So in WebAuthor, I have to log in with GitHub. In WebAuthor, subject matter experts won't see that actually the images folder is took from another project. The link is seamless. They also won't see that the reusable folder comes from another project. And let's say someone wants to add to the DITA map to add the copyright page. they just have to go here, say include a topic reference, and go to reusables, copyright that DITA, and the link it's inserted. They can also switch to view topic titles, which connects to GitLab to fetch the titles of the topics, and so and the title of the file that it's included in another repository appears here, so everything is transparent for the users. So this is the experience in Web Author. While if they use the traditional way of doing things, they would clone the Git repository. They would notice at some point that parts of the content are missing, that they receive errors like this link points to a non-existing file. They somehow try to figure out what's going on, and at some point they find the missing command that they should update the submodule. And they should also run this submodule update command regularly to pull the content from these external content repositories. So this is the first task, accessing the XML content. The second task, ordered by difficulty, is reading the XML content. So I already showed you that it is possible to view the task, the topic titles in a DITA map instead of the link targets. We also implemented this one. Yes.
Just wanted to clarify that this what you presented are more or less additions to the main support of the web author that allow you to point directly to a file and have that encoded as a URL. So not only to a folder in a repository, but point directly with the URL to a file.
Yeah, so at some point I showed you the link to the CMIS user home, which is basically an URL that points to a folder, but web author can also, you can also share a web author URL that points directly to a file if you want to. So, but yeah, I forgot this because this is a feature
that's
that we had from day one, yeah. Yeah, so if you copy this link and send it to someone else, they will be able to open the exact file that you have in front of you. Okay, so this is the growing flower map, and it is possible to switch it to view topic content. And with this view, people will be able to read the entire DITA map as a almost like published form. It's very similar to the PDF output, but they will, for example, have access to the comments that are made in the entire DITA map. They will see all the comments here on the right side. If they click here, they will be taken to the right location. They can also search for some word that appears somewhere in the DITA map, and so on. There is also another view mode that shows the titles of the topics. This is useful if you want to reorder the table of contents of the publication. And there are a lot of possible views that are that can be used to read the same XML content, and the best way to view it depends on the task that you are trying to perform. For example, if you want to decide which of the topics will go in a printed output, maybe the best way is to enable edit topic ref attributes in place. This will add an edit button after each after each entry in the DITA map, and there will be a basically, if you click it, it will expand to show you all the possible attributes. So here it's you get to choose which product this topic is for, whether this is included in the table of contents or not, the scope, and so on. You can also specify a nav title for this topic ref. So actually the power of this customizability is that in a particular company you can identify better what common tasks are people doing with the content and configuring the editor to present a view that is most useful for them. Okay, let's move on. Another thing that makes XML difficult to read is that at some point you have conditional context. For example, in one topic in our user manual, there is a snippet like this. Recommended is 4 GB of RAM and 2 GB. And at the first sight, it's a mistake here. It's duplicated information. And actually, the problem is that to obtain this screenshot, I disabled some features of the editor. And actually, the way this information is presented is this way. So in the XML content, it says that the recommended memory is 4 GB of RAM if the product is author, developer, or editor, and 2 GB if the product is SVN client. And now it starts to make more sense. So as a reviewer which doesn't know XML, in a review process, I would report this as a mistake. But if I see this, it will start to make sense. In WebAuthor, for some time, we had support for profiling attributes in DITA. In this version, we also added support for profiling attributes in a DITA specialization, and also we started to show content that is not meant for the current product as grayed out. So if the editor is opened in the context of a particular product, then the content for other products will be grayed out. Another feature that makes content hard to read is that in DITA, but in general, maybe not also in other XML vocabularies, we use variables. So this sentence is like, it is possible for your organization to use your own CF enterprise server to store the uploaded content rather than the server hosted by the CF public. And it's hard to understand what these variables mean. But if we present the content like this, so if to use your own Oxygen Content Fusion enterprise server, or the server hosted by Oxygen Content Fusion demo service. This is much easier to read and understand by subject matter experts. WebAuthor did this from day one, but more recently we covered even more use cases. For example, in our user manual, the value of the variables depend on the product that you are looking at. So if you open, so I will show you, for example, in our documentation. So here is the getting started section for Oxygen XML Editor. For Oxygen XML Author, the section is almost similar, just that the name of the product is Oxygen XML Author. And until recently, we didn't take DITA val files into account. So every time you would open a topic, you would open the getting started section, you will see Oxygen XML editor. So while this makes sense in general, we had this problem with this edit online links. So if you click that link, you will be shown the topic that generated this output file will be open in the web author. And here, if you would expect to see a content that is very almost the same as the one presented in the web help. So here you will also see author, but if you would see editor here, you will think that there is a mistake, that in the author manual there is a reference to the editor product, and you would report this in a review process. So in the latest version, web author will also take into account this profiling information. Okay. Then we will go to the next step in writing, in contributing to content. To content is actually writing text. A feature that we added recently is the support for custom term dictionaries. For example, in our documentation, we use GitHub a lot, but sometimes people just write it without capital H, or just GitHub with capital letters here. And we wanted to make sure that the usage of the term is consistent across our documentation. So we created a plugin that you can feed with the dictionary file like this. This file can be a local file on the web author server or read from a REST service. And if you configure the plugin correctly, then people will receive an error when they so if you write GitHub, there is no error shown, but if you write GitHub, it reports an error and proposes you to correct to GitHub. And so it's just a simple way to ensure terminology consistency in documentation. And what we also did is to add a learn word action that will add the current word to that dictionary. And in an integration, people would enable this action only for, maybe not for SMEs, but for technical writers that know what the terminology should be. So they can update the terminology file from the editor itself. Also, now it's possible to configure the autocorrect feature. So before that, we had some simple use cases like correcting TEH to the, which is a basic thing. But now you can create a file with this format that will help you also avoid mistakes. So in our documentation, we should never write Oxygen with capital X, although the logo contains capital X, but in the documentation, it should always be Oxygen with capital O. So I added an autocorrect rule that converts to the correct form. So it would be a lot harder for people to write the bad form of the product name. Uh, Another things that WebAuthor has to improve writing text is that, so by default we use the same spell checker that OpenOffice does, but it has some limitations. For example, the supported languages are somehow limited. It supports English, French, German, and I think another one or two languages. And so we created an API for implementing customs, for integrating custom spell checkers. And we started to work on a plugin that adds support for the language tool spell checker, which adds support for some extra languages like Spanish, simplified Chinese, Italian, Dutch, and Japanese. We also received requests on our support channels for specific spell checkers. I don't remember the name, but for French, it seems that there is a specialized spell checker for French, and people use that. But they, with this API, people will be able to integrate any spell checker. There is also a third-party plugin developed by AcroLinks that does a lot of language-related checks on the document. For example, here it says that the phrase is too long, maybe we should split it. Here it says that I'm saying they are, maybe if we want to be less formal, we should use the abbreviated form, which we can do like this. And actually, it has a lot of configurations about what kind of language are we supposed to use to configure the terminology and so on. This is a third-party plugin. It's not included in WebAuthor, but can be easily installed. Okay, another feature that we added to to help people write content is the support for custom placeholder. So if an element is empty, by default, it writes the name of the element. Sometimes the name of the element is not relevant to the user. So to make things even easier, we created a special processing instruction called oxy placeholder that lets you specify some text to be displayed when the element is empty. And when people try to write it, the processing instruction is deleted and their content will appear there. Okay, so now we increase one more level. So after adding text, people need to add also some markup. For example, we have several ways to insert markup. For example, there is this toolbar that lets you insert, like make things bold, like adding links. Actually, here the editor put the HTTP in front of the URL because it knew it has to be there. You can insert images by browsing the file server for images. You can also insert new paragraphs by just pressing enter. And actually, if you insert a list, Enter will insert a new list item, except for the last item where it will be converted to a paragraph again. And we also included a lot of improvements to the content completion menu that can be invoked by Control Enter. So first of all, instead of writing the XML name of the element, like B, we write an English name for it. And we also display on the right-hand side a description of the element and maybe some use cases for that element. The default documentation that we show is taken from the DITA specification, but in some companies they have a specific style guide that mandates how some elements should be used, and this description is configurable to make it more useful for users in that company. So here we also include links to the style guide and to the DITA specification, which are also configurable. If you have an internal style guide, you can add links to that style guide. Okay. And another feature that we added recently is enabling content completion in text mode, like section it works for files that have a DTD schema. Actually, this is interesting because it was requested by subject matter experts in a company, which actually were software developers, and they said that they would prefer to work in the text mode rather than in the author mode, although we thought the contrary. Okay, another thing that we invested a lot in the new release is the tables support. So now it's easier to perform some tasks working with tables. So for example, this is a feature matrix between Oxygen XML Web Author and Oxygen XML Author. So let's say this column about mobile device friendly, I want to move it to a secondary place because nobody uses a mobile device for actual work. So I put it on the last position. Then let's say I want to have all the feature names written in bold, and I can just select the column and write bold. And let's say I also want to insert a column about content fusion. So I can go here, insert column after. Most of the values will be common for Web Author and Content Fusion. So I can just copy this column and paste it here. And just change the title and maybe just making some change here. Also for some of the sections, some of the answers, maybe I just want a single cell here. So I can select a couple of cells and then press join to make them a single one, and then split it again in a 2x2 grid. And we also implemented for calls tables, for DITA tables, we implemented the table properties action that you can use, for example, to change the horizontal alignment of a column to right. So every So all the text in the first column is now aligned to the right. Okay. We also wanted to make people. So one of the advantages to use XML is that you can very easily reuse content. But reusing content may be a hard task for users. If they just write content from time to time, maybe they just go and type in the product name instead of using a variable for that, especially if it's kind of difficult. So here I have a DITA map that is one of the samples in the oxygen distribution. So here the talking circle is the name of the product, and we have here a comment saying we can use the keyword instead of plain text. So what I can do is delete this and then go to this new DITA keys view, see that I have a variable defined for the talking for the product name, and insert it. Actually, in a larger product, there will be a lot of keys. I can just type, filter the list of the keys and choose the one that makes sense for a particular context. Another way that we made reusing content easier is the following. So in a DITA topic, you can link to another file in two ways. You can link it directly by providing the file path, or link to it providing the key reference. So here this link is to the topic that has the key genus. And sometimes the names of the keys are automatically generated, and it's kind of hard for people to find the right key to insert. So what we did is we changed the way in which the cross-reference action works. So for example, if you choose to insert a link to the glossary bulb, you have to browse to the specific file. This file chooser is the default one, but if you are using a CMS, you can have a view that is specific to the CMS that can let you search for files in a much easier way. So you select this file, and then there is only one possible link target in this file, and choose to insert it. And web author automatically inserts a key ref for you if a key is defined for this topic. So you are basically using DITA keys without even knowing. Okay, so the next step. So up until this point, people were only editing existing content. Now we will focus on how people are able to create new content. For example, what we did is to try to make the template chooser more useful. For example, in DITA there are a lot of document types, and it's somehow a trade-off. You could put only the most popular ones in the chooser, but then people won't be able to create a gloss entry, for example, because it's not very popular. But from time to time, you want people to be able. No, gloss entry is already here. Let's look for someone else. A learning map. So people should be able to create a learning map if they want to. But most of the time, they will create topics, concepts, tasks, and so on. So we created a special category for displaying the most popular templates. A template A popular template is one that is configured by the server administrator to be popular. And another useful feature is that for each of the templates, we included a small note about when people should use that template. Again, for DITA templates, we took the description from the DITA specification, but in a particular company, people might create templates like knowledge base article or tutorial or release notes and have a description which makes sense in their context. This is entirely customizable. We just try to provide decent defaults for these descriptions. And one thing that we added in this last release is the ability to work with markdown files. So currently I can create a new markdown file. So let's create another markdown file. So, and we have a simple markdown editor with a syntax highlight. For example, if you write lists, they will be highlighted. If you make things bold, or no, this is italic, this is bold, this is a code block, and so on. And after you edit this file, you will be able to commit it on GitLab or GitHub or whatever you are using. So this is another good way for people to start writing content. One thing that we will do next is to add the option to convert to DITA, so people, while they are just drafting the content, they could just write markdown and then convert to DITA and take care of the markup issues. Okay, and so after creating new files. Now I will show you how easy it can be for people to create an entirely new projects, to create a setup for a project. For example, I created a GitHub repository with a template for the XML Prague conference. So the paper is stored in this repository. It's actually the official template found on the conference website. And we have a publish script that uses Oxygen PDF chemistry to generate a PDF out of it. And I created a setup that involves WebAuthor, GitHub, and Netlify. So WebAuthor is the editor that edits the template that is stored on GitHub. And Netlify is kind of a continuous integration plus publishing platform. So every time you commit a new version of the paper to the Git repository, Netlify will automatically update the website that contains the PDF version of it. So here is an example. So this is the generated website. I can click here to view the docbook PDF output obtained from this file using chemistry. And I can also click the edit source link to load this file in WebAuthor. So let's say here, if I change the name to WebAuthor and commit, the change will be immediately available on GitHub. And in a minute or so, the PDF version will be also updated. And what's even nicer is that Netlify offers a nice deploy to Netlify button that allows you to basically replicate the entire setup in your Git account. So you just copy the template together with all the setup and you just start writing on the paper and it will automatically build the PDF every time you change something. Another similar example is a wiki, which is based on DITA, Markdown, and Oxygen Web Help and Web Author. So this is a. Let's first look at the source. So the wiki system it's a GitHub repository. In the wiki folder, it contains the actual content, some data topics, a markdown file. And it also contains a publish script that uses it uses Oxygen Web Help to publish this nice website from the content that is in that repository. So from data content in the GitHub repository, you get this website also stored on Netlify. And what's nice is that each of the topics has an edit online button that opens that file in Web Author. And if you make some change to this file, again, it will trigger a republish of the entire wiki, and in a minute or so, the output will be updated. And the best part about this is, again, it comes with a deploy a Netlify button that is just a small web-based wizard that will allow you to replicate this wiki system. So here is the DITA topic that I can edit. And by now the changed PDF version should already be here, so yeah. Okay, so this brings it to the end of the presentation. Thank you for listening. If there are any questions.
So did you get to use the web author from Oxygen?
Good stuff.
Don't be shy.
Yeah, we use it. We find it to be very useful. I mean, it's a perfect fit for what we're trying to do. So we don't use it exactly that way. We kind of embed it in our own wrapper,
mm-hmm.
but we have a custom XML. We don't use the DITA, and it's very extensible, and it's working out well for us.
So Christy presented some of the latest additions
yes.
to the web author. As I mentioned, the core functionality is that you can have a URL that basically brings you to a file. So once you, wherever you can embed the URL, you can embed the access to enable someone to edit that file, the source of that, the XML source of the file. That's why we include the edit links, for instance. Both you can have them in HTML output or in PDF even. So you can have a PDF for review, but then rather than highlighting on the PDF, people can just follow the link to the actual source and modify there. And then the PDF can be automatically updated, let's say, to reflect those changes. And the addition is that
together with the URL, so the URL that will edit a file basically point is a web service that has a parameter that points to that file. Now we can add parameters that point to the context. We had the DITA map as the context to resolve keys and subject scheme values and everything that comes from the root map. But now you can also point to a DITA val as the filter. So then you can have grayed out some parts of the content that are not part of that deliverable. Let's say in our case we have a deliverable for the desktop auto product. So the parts that are related to XSLT debugging, for instance, are not part in that deliverable. So they are presented grayed out to someone.
Yeah. If you have questions, like the next day, you'll find me around. So please don't hesitate.
Yes.
Well, I wonder whether there are some features, some of the cool new features in the web author now that you plan also to integrate in the Oxygen editor in the next version.
Is there anything that's on the web author and is not in the standalone version? Maybe that they use in the standalone version when you select a topic, I think we show you that there's the key available and we allow you to choose the
yeah.
key. It's not automatically because we yeah. want you to have more control.
So most of the features are presented, are also present in the editor, but in a slightly different way. So in the editor, the focus is on productivity and flexibility, while in WebAuthor. So for example, in WebAuthor, we think that instead of adding like a lot of options in a dialogue that people wouldn't understand anyway, we just simplify the dialogue. While in the editor, we design the interface for people that are familiar with XML and know what they are doing, but they need to do it fast and to be able to and to have the flexibility that they require. So did you see a did you see a feature that you don't have in the editor?
I just have to think it through. I'm not sure.
They are there.
Will work also in the author mode of the editor of the standalone mm-hmm. version, but I just don't know
how they should
do
be
it.
There. Yeah.
Yeah.
Most of them should be there. Yeah.
Yeah. This grayed out thing is you have something that's called profiling condition set, and you can focus on a specific deliverable.
I'm curious how far you could push the table functions populating like values in the data. So I have a features comparison. So I have two models, and on the left hand side I have my features and my metadata, the stuff that's common. And what my developers would like to do is they would like to populate those tables with their value of a product, just maybe from their Excel file or something. So I could maybe have my table set up on a key reference value, maybe have like a comma separated value from the Excel, or maybe a fancy XPath, someone's got a response, well, why don't you just do a query on it, just to read the data in. Because they would use it and say, well, I want to go to the next step further, because I'm really lazy as a developer.
So you want to have the source of truth in the Excel and just import it there, or just...
So I have my review form, my table that I'm uh-huh. using for authoring, that means for like a specification. Now the developer just drags his Excel sheet, or just calls.
So what you can do is to copy paste from an Excel sheet should work.
I don't want to do a copy paste.
Oh, you want to be automatically updated whenever you change the.
So I take my Excel sheet, I just throw it in a location on in my files resources. And then just do update.
Yeah, we support that in the desktop version through the convert, dynamic convert protocols idea that we presented.
So the problem is
2 years ago with XML
Prague. The problem is not necessarily during editing, but so in the desktop editor we have this support to somehow magically import from live import from Excel.
I have my alfresco set somewhere, my CIMS.
Uh huh.
They have their site that they always use, or my GitHub, and mm-hmm. I know that I tell them, okay, put your data here, and whatever's in that folder, I'll pick it up.
There are also some more problems when you try to publish. So we have some editor specific configuration that you can use to bring in the data while presenting it in the editor. But then when you try to publish, there will be another set of problems. Maybe that's why this idea didn't get too much traction in the desktop editor, because people would see the content in the editor, but when they publish, they wouldn't.
So if you are in the DITA world, Radu also made available a plugin that understands Excel file in the similar way as DITA.OT and Oxygen understand markup as DITA, right? So basically you can use Excel in a DITA project with that plugin that Radu provides for the DITA Open Toolkit. For the publishing time, you'll be able to have that working. Also, the approach that we have with the Convert protocol, but then you need to publish from Oxygen.
Well, we're just being at a review chat, because I'm reviewing, right? My SMEs are reviewing the data, and say, what should they have?
But that does not work right now in the web order, I think. I don't know if...
No, that plugin doesn't work. But the API allows you to present an Excel table in the editor. Like we have for.
I don't necessarily want the Excel table as much as I want the data in my Excel table.
Yeah, of course.
What you can do in this approach is that basically, as we trigger the PDF publishing when you commit something to GitHub, you can trigger a conversion from that Excel file to DITA. So you can have a generated DITA topic that is not editable by hand, but is generated whenever the Excel file is committed.
It's committed.
So then you have that, you know, mirroring that data. So that's the easiest way, probably.
Okay, good.
And you don't bother with the
more
dynamic conversion. So you can do it whenever that file is updated on the repository.
Yeah. And then that's it. Concept,
yeah. Okay, so we are, I think, at the end of the session.
The beginning of the lunch
break. Enjoy the lunch break, and we hope you will join us also after the lunch break, where Alex will present how you can customize Oxygen for a specific XML vocabulary, because the support that we have for DITA, DOBook, TI, XHTML, and so on, a number of XML languages, is not hard-coded into the core of Oxygen. It comes as part of a configuration package that can be built by anyone, can be extended, or can be built for a completely new XML vocabulary. It's just that we ship this together with Oxygen, but it's not, you know, necessarily hard-coded into Oxygen.